No mai, haere mai. Welcome to the Maxim Institute podcast. My name is Jason, and I'm the communications manager at Maxim Institute. This is our weekly short form podcast. These podcasts are released in tandem with our weekly column and are a chance for you to hear in depth from the column's author about some of the thinking that went into producing their final piece. Today we talk to researcher Maryanne Spurdle about her latest column. Maryanne, welcome along to the podcast this week.
Thanks, Jason.
Always good to have you with us. We're talking about your recent column, Cake One Day, Crumbs the Next. Now, this column grew out of a week of contrasts, I guess you would say, in that throughout the week we had heard different reports on the economy. We don't have enough money. We're going into a recession. The IMF saying we're not doing well compared to other nations coming out of COVID. And then Grant Robertson, former finance minister's valedictory speech to Parliament, where he talked about his balanced approach to the economy over his 6 years as finance minister. And you had something to say about that, Maryanne. So how do we square this circle of recession versus an apparently balanced approach?
Well, I think Grant Robertson would defend himself by saying he had a balanced approach. Circumstances meant that we were going to face a double deception.
Something out of my control, yes.
And I don't know what he'd say about the IMF saying that New Zealand's an outlier. We have racked up more debt over recent years than other developed economies. And I think right there that shows that something has gone different here compared to overseas. We all went through COVID. We all had kind of indifferent responses to it from our leaders that had, you know, lasting side effects. But here, we're not seeing a recovery and the rate of debt is growing, you know, at an unsustainable rate.
So this is like a management issue more than and a leadership, like a top level issue. It's not something that people on the ground are.
It's definitely something that the former finance minister had a hand in.
That's a good way of putting it. So what are some of the signs that you've pointed to, a few of them here, that kind of show that maybe the approach wasn't as balanced as?
Yeah, the numbers that kind of tell the story about how central government has got bigger while not providing bigger outcomes for us. Is a clue that it wasn't managed well.
Yeah.
If you're going to put more money into the public service, you'd expect more public services. Instead, we have billions of dollars of additional debt to pay for public services, and we've got worse roads, worse healthcare, worse education.
Teachers leaving the teaching profession.
Yes, teachers are no happier today.
Doctors and nurses and dentists and police officers.
So, yeah, what have we got for our billions of dollars of debt? I can't think of any public service where we can point to it and go, oh, Grant Robertson, at least he did that.
Which is interesting because you hear public servants now saying, oh, we can't find any places to cut jobs. We have this target where we have to, because we've got so much debt now, we're looking to lower public service. But
the easiest way to deal with debt is to not spend money.
Yes. Yeah.
There's money coming into the government coffers. The less that goes out, the easier the debt will be to manage. So if we even took the public service back to 2017 levels, that would save hugely. The idea that a ministry can't shave off 4% when it's grown. Let's see, the numbers between 2017 and 2022, the public service grew by 28%.
Oh,
so that's you know, more than a quarter of the public service staffers being added to it, while total employment in New Zealand grew by 12%. So it's 2.5 times
the rate of growth.
Everything else.
Yeah.
The previous 9 years during the John Key Bill English government, the public service grew by 6%, and the total New Zealand employment grew by 19%. It was quite the reverse. So we didn't need the public service to grow that much. And based on the outcomes, I don't see any problem with it shrinking by that much.
So over the last 6 years, the public service has grown by 28%.
Yep.
And so that's kind of where the money's gone, supposedly.
A lot of it is. And you've got to remember that when we're talking about people working for, you know, the public service, the average salary, and this is 2 years ago, the average salary was almost $91,000. With the Ministry of Education, which is a great little microcosm of what's going on in central government, in just the past 3 years, they've gone from 2,900 staff to 4,311.
So they've almost doubled in 3 years.
Well, that's not quite double, but it's about 1,400 more staff. And they've got contractors. That's not everybody. Yeah. Like the people working on the curriculum, a lot of them are contractors. And if you go
and
back
these are not frontline staff though, right? So these are not teachers.
No, these are people who, and I think about a quarter of their staff support other people doing their jobs. So if you trimmed a little bit there, you'd save a lot. The people working for the Ministry of Education on average earn over $100,000 more a year than the average teacher.
What?
So, they're recruiting from classrooms. A lot of principals are losing experienced staff to the Ministry of Education.
Well, it makes sense if you're going to earn over $100,000 more.
Yeah, just and it's
for
probably
going
to be closer to $200,000. So it would be
one
nice if some of them went back to a classroom.
And you could pay for like two or three teachers in the classroom as a...
Well, you could, yeah. If you return to staffing levels from even just 3 years ago, you could get at least 500 wages. So that shows what the ministry values. The ministry values the ministry.
Mm.
It pays its own people more. It's adding to its staff roles. Teachers are less supported. Student outcomes are worse. So it's just one little hint that the priorities are wrong. And the philosophy is if you put more money into it and if you add more decision makers, then you're going to have better outcomes. It doesn't look like that happens.
Yeah. What do they say? Too many chefs in the kitchen spoil the broth, right? There's too many chefs.
One of my favorite movie lines, the old movie Sabrina, more isn't always better, Linus. Sometimes it's just more.
Yeah, that's right. That's so true. Oh my! And so the education ministry, the Ministry of Education, is kind of writ large across all our different ministries, and they're going, "Oh, we want to keep our office staff employed."
Yeah, that's the one.
We don't want to have frontline. We don't necessarily. We'll cut frontline staff before we cut back office staff. Is that kind of the?
I don't know that they're cutting frontline staff, but the priority is the ministry's priority seems to be the
self,
ministry.
Yeah. So, how can we, other than I guess, trying to reduce bureaucracy, that's kind of the way out of this. Is that what you see, or
it's one of the pieces of the puzzle? I'm not an economist, and I don't want Nicola Willis's job, but it's just one area where, especially over that week that Grant Robertson was saying his farewells, and it was a very entertaining farewell. I like him a lot better now that he's not the
Minister of Finance.
Because I don't think that was really his best kind of performance that. So going forward, it's going to take some tough decisions, partly because we're in the condition that we're in. We don't have a buffer to play with. And even if we did have a buffer to play with, we would hope that there'd be good management that would be looking at outcomes and not just assuming, you know, taking the easy option, which is we're signaling we care about this by putting money and staff and everything. We're going to add to that, so we must be prioritizing it instead of going, we're prioritizing this and we're going to figure out the actual most effective way of doing it. There's trade-offs everywhere. We don't have infinite resources. We can't just keep printing money. So we have to figure out what are the key areas that we do want to invest in and what's the most clever way to invest in it. And that's going to mean not doing some things that people, that voters are going to be unhappy about. Mm. But we can't do those things now given our resources. Mm.
So it sounds like we may have to eat some broccoli before we get to the cake.
Yeah.
Wow, there's a lot to think about, Maryanne, and a lot of, I guess, deep thinking that the government and all of us are going to have to do as we face the future. So thanks for having the conversation.
Thanks, Jason. After years of aspirational leadership, we've been served a cold slice of reality in place of the delectable cake of good intentions. Headlines announcing former Finance Minister Grant Robertson's farewell to Parliament competed with stories of abrupt cuts to ministries and public services, and the news were officially in a recession. Robertson's valedictory speech brimmed with fond memories, good laughs, and the straight-faced claim that he had been committed to balance in his recipes for our economy. However, just hours earlier, the IMF painted a different picture of his financial management. Quote, debt increased more rapidly than in many advanced economies in recent years and will continue its upward trajectory absent decisive consolidation, end quote. New Zealand hasn't simply been a victim of global setbacks. We elected people who were masters at expressing good intentions without questioning the viability of their plans. Good intentions untethered from reality are a recipe for disappointment. By untethered, I mean promising schools more and fancier buildings than the Ministry of Education ever had funds for, or pouring money into businesses affected by government-imposed lockdowns without matching that generosity with accountability, or beginning ambitious infrastructure projects without the means to finish them. Robertson and his colleagues were fond of impossible goals. They chased zero road deaths, zero child poverty, and a smoke-free Aotearoa while making zero dents in any of those problems. Unless, that is, you call replacing each ex-cigarette smoker with an even younger vapor progress. Higher taxes and even new taxes may be the price we end up paying for this well-intentioned lack of good management. Returning public service staffing levels to at least 2017 levels is a reasonable place to start addressing the government's spending excesses. Despite what the Public Service Association tells us, each additional back office staff member does not automatically improve services. Is the Ministry of Education, for instance, performing better today with 4,311 staff plus contractors than it did 3 years ago with 2,900? Literacy scores are down, ditto attendance, and teachers are fleeing the profession. Since the year 2000, student numbers have grown 14%, while the number of ministry staff has grown 620%. The fact that they are paid, on average, tens of thousands of dollars a year more than actual teachers gives us a clue as to who the government thinks is more valuable. While the ministry bursts at the seams, teachers are less supported than ever, and students' academic performance continues to decline. We have passed the point at which size becomes inversely related to value. The same applies to healthcare, welfare, and infrastructure. We don't need more cooks in the kitchen. We need better ones. This government is faced with a brutal task as New Zealand slips away from the economic recovery most other countries are experiencing. It can either put national services on a strict diet or continue serving up tucker that we and our children will be paying back for years to come. If we don't tighten our belts today, cake won't be on the menu tomorrow.
Thanks for listening to the Maxim Institute podcast. If you'd like to hear more from us and keep up with the rest of our research and analysis of politics and policy in New Zealand, you can sign up on the homepage of our website to get our monthly forum email and invitations to future Maxim Institute events. You can search and subscribe to us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, iHeartRadio, or wherever you get your podcasts. From the team at Maxim, mā te wā, goodbye for now.